Time for convening haven't arrived. The Senate will come to order. Would ask unauthorized visitors to exit chamber at this time, and the Senate will come to order. Chair recognizes the distinguished senator from the 54th.
Thank you, Mr. President. The journal has been read and found to be correct.
Thank you, Senator, for your good works on the journal. Is there objection dispensing with the reading of the journal? Reading of the journal is dispensed with. Is there objection confirmation of the journal? Chair is none, and the journal is confirmed. All senators having bills and resolutions to introduce, please bring them to the Secretary's desk at this time. First reading and reference of Senate bills and resolutions.
Senate Bill 308 by Senators Ford of the 39th and others. A bill to be entitled an act.
Appropriations.
Senate Bill 309 by Senators Tate of the 38th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 48215 of the OCGA relating to confidential taxpayer
finance.
Information. SB 310 by Senators Tate of the 38th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 5 of Title
41. Ethics Committee.
Senate Bill 311 by Senators Ford of the 39th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 2 of Title
Ethics Committee.
Senate Bill 312 by Senators Thompson of the 5th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Title
41. Judiciary.
Senate Bill 313 by Senators Ford and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 487A3.
Finance.
Senate Bill 314 by Senator James of the 35th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 4 of Title 34 of the OCGA.
Insurance and Labor.
Senate Bill 315 by Senators Jones of the 10th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 2 of Title 21 of the OCGA relating to
Ethics Committee.
Senate Bill 316 by Senators Henson of the 41st and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Title 45 of the OCGA relating to public
government office. Oversight.
SB 317 by Senators Jackson of the 2nd and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Article 3 of Chapter 27 of Title 50 of the OCGA relating to
government oversight.
Senate Bill 318 by Senators Jackson of the 2nd and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 337.
Regulated industries.
Senate Bill 319 by Senators Jackson of the 2nd and Senator Hobartson of the 15th. A bill to be entitled.
Education and youth.
Senate Bill 320 by Senator Hobartson of the 15th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 1 of Title 15 of the OCGA relating to general
judiciary non-civil.
Senate Bill 321 by Senator Jones of the 10th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Subpart 2 of Part 2.
Education and youth.
Senate Bill 322 by Senators Hobbs of the 7th and others.
Natural resources.
Senate Bill 323 by Senators Hill of the 6th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 5 of Title 40.
Public safety.
Senate Resolution 777 by Senators Tate of the 38th and others. A resolution creating the Senate Special Tax
Finance Committee.
Senate Resolution 782 by Senators Hill of the 6th and others. A resolution
retirement.
Senate Resolution 783 by Senators Heath of the 31st and others. A resolution for proposing
finance.
That completes the order, Mr. President.
Clerk will read reports of standing committees.
Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Finance has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. That House Bill 399 do pass, that Senate Resolution 415 do pass. Respectfully submitted, Senator Hill of the 32nd District Chairman. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Health and Human Services has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. The Senate Resolution 746 do pass, that Senate Bill 291 do pass, that Senate Bill 292 do pass, that Senate Bill 273 do pass by substitute. Respectfully submitted, Senator Unterman of the 45th District Chairman. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Higher Education has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. That Senate Bill 214 do pass by substitute. Respectfully submitted, Senator Counselor of the 46th District Chairman. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Insurance and Labor has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. That House Bill 229 do pass, that House Bill 375 do pass by substitute. Respectfully submitted, Senator Golden of the 8th District Chairman. Mr. President, the Senate Committee on Natural Resources and the Environment has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. The Senate Bill 296 do pass. Respectfully submitted, Senator Tolleson of the 20th District Chairman. Mr. President, the Senate Public Safety Committee has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. The Senate Bill 298 do pass. Respectfully submitted, Senator Carter, the 1st District Chairman. Mr. President, the Senate State and Local Government Operations Committee has had under consideration the following legislation and has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. The House Bill 768 do pass. Respectfully submitted, Senator Ligon of the 3rd District Chairman. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Clerk will read second readers.
Senate Bill 240, Senate Bill 286, Senate Bill 294. That completes the order, Mr. President.
It is is now time for the morning roll call. Time for the morning roll call. Are there motions to excuse? Chair recognizes Senator from the 33rd.
I'd ask unanimous consent to. I'm not going to do that. I thought better of it.
All right, very good. Are there any other motions to excuse? Chair recognizes Senator from the 34th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the senator from the 36th. She is en route.
36, without objection, senator will be excused. Chair recognizes the distinguished senator from Harrelson, 31st.
Mr. President, I'd like to request that we look through the journals and see how long it's been since the senator from the 33rd was here to ask for someone to be excused for roll call.
You know, I tell you what, we'd have to look long and far and deep and wide to see that, I can assure you. Chair recognizes the 15th.
President, I move to excuse the senator from the second out of the Capitol on business.
Second, without objection, senator from the second will be excused. Any other motions to excuse? Any other motions to excuse? While I have the Senate's attention, let me just allow us to pause for a moment. Many of you know our director of the Senate Research, Jill Fike, wonderful lady who does a remarkable job on the behalf of the state Senate. Her father has passed away, and I know that each of you will join me in offering our condolences and keeping her and the family in our thoughts and prayers. He passed away on Monday. Senator from the 11th is recognized.
I'd like to request unanimous consent for Senator from the 8th, business.
Eight, without objection, Senator from the 8th will be excused. Are there any other motions? Secretary will call the roll. Senator, signify your presence by voting the yay switch. The Secretary will unlock the machine. It is now time for our morning devotion. Would ask senators to take your seats, cease conversation, and prepare the chamber for our morning devotion. Doorkeepers will secure the chamber at this time. It is now my distinct honor to call upon the very distinguished chair of the Rules Committee, the senator from the 53rd, to lead us in our pledge and introduce our chaplain of the day. Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. Would you join me in honoring our country? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And our state, please.
I pledge allegiance to the state flag and to the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation.
Good morning, everybody, on this cold, brisk day. It's only 6 degrees in Chickamauga, and so the pastor of the day came down here to get some heat, to get in some warm weather. Pastor Joe Brown has just celebrated his 25th year at the Battlefield Parkway Church of the Nazarene at Fort Oglethorpe, Georgia. His wife, Jean, and he have three children, Jody, Jennifer, and Jessica. Pastor Brown has been a pastor for 32 years. He's graduated from the Nazarene Theological Seminary with Master's in Divinity. And he's a spiritual leader of our area, and he is well sought out for his wisdom and his guidance in these matters. Would you please give your attention to Pastor Joe Brown.
Well, this is an awesome experience as I come. I can't tell you how many times I have come up I-75 during college days and seminary days. Look over to my right or left, depending on which direction I was going, and see this very special building and this Golden Dome, and think about all the things that were taking place. And as I come to you today, I am just a simple man. But I am Georgia through and through. I was born in Athens, Georgia, spent 2 months there, and then my parents moved us to Dublin, Georgia, the heart of Georgia, Lawrence County, and was raised there for 18 years. I came to know the Lord at the First Church of the Nazarene in Dublin, Georgia, right there off Telfair Street, and then I went to college and seminary, and I've spent the last 25 years trying to take care of the northern border there in Fort Oglethorpe, Georgia. So I love Georgia, and it is really an honor and a privilege for me to be here, and it really is an awesome experience for me. And as I think about that, I hope that today could be an awesome experience with you. And as I think about that, my mind goes to an Old Testament book, the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, chapter 28. I love reading the Old Testament because it's full of stories. And we all like a good story. And the truth of the matter is, we're all in the process of living a story. And so that's the best way that God chose to reveal himself to us, was by telling us the story of people who were wrestling with him, trying to figure out who he is and the kind of experience they had with him. In Genesis chapter 28, you come across a very interesting man named Jacob. And Jacob is on his way back to his mother's homeland to find a wife. He's excited about the future, but he also knows that he's a man with a past. Things have not gone too well for Jacob in recent days. His brother is so angry with him that he wants to find him, and the Bible says he wants to kill him. Why? Because Jacob, which his name means deceiver, had deceived his brother out of his birthright and his blessing. To give things an opportunity to cool down, his mother had come up with the idea that he go back to her homeland to find a wife. In chapter 28, he comes to a very interesting place. The sun is going down, and Jacob realizes that it's time to rest for the night. And one of the things that catches my attention about that particular story is that he chooses a rock for a pillar. Now, I don't know about you, but it makes all the difference in the world if I have my pillow. I have my very own special pillow, and it's got to be soft, and it's got to be just right. And I can't imagine sleeping through the night using a rock as a pillow. But that's exactly what he does, and I can understand why he had a hard time sleeping that night. But as he was sleeping that night, he had a dream. He could understand that he was on earth, but he had a vision of heaven. Now, I want you to know something about Jacob. Jacob had learned about God all his life from his father and his grandfather, Abraham, Isaac. But those were just things he had learned. Heaven and earth, oh, there seems to be a great distance between things going on in heaven and things going on down here on earth. But that night, as Jacob had his dream, he saw a ladder, and he saw angels ascending and descending on that ladder. And Jacob discovered that he was sleeping in God's super highway. It's one thing to have a rock for a pillow. It's another thing to go to sleep in God's super highway. My church is located on Battlefield Parkway. The last thing I would think of doing is getting my favorite pillow, going out in the middle of Battlefield Parkway and going to sleep. But that's exactly what happened to Jacob. And he woke up, and this is what he said: "Surely the Lord is in this place. And I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." I know that today you're going to be dealing with earthly matters. And I know that today you'll be making decisions and wrestlings with issues that will make life better for all us who claim Georgia as the place to live our lives. But my prayer today is that this would be an awesome day for you, that heaven would break in, and that you would realize that you really are a very special place where you are making important decisions for people who live across this great state. I count it such an honor to be with you this morning and to remind you that you can have an awesome day by letting God show up in this place. Let's pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Heavenly Father, would you give us this day our daily bread? And would you forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us? And will you lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil? For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you so much.
All right.
Are there any unanimous consents? Any senator wishing to rise on a point of personal privilege? Chair recognizes Senator from the 39th for a point of personal privilege.
Good morning. I rise on a point of personal privilege to make the body aware of a piece of legislation that is very important to all Georgians, and in particular about 600,000 Georgians who have been affected by the recent events with the state health benefits plan. We have had changes in the state health benefit plan that have caused widespread and thorough concern amongst teachers and other state employees in the state health benefit plan. Right now, we have one carrier, one insurance company that covers 650,000 people, just one company. And that situation robs the state employees, robs teachers of choice. I assume that most people in this chamber, if not all, believe in the free market. That is, there ought to be choices, there ought to be competition, and right now, that does not exist. I have a piece of legislation in my hand, and it's here for anyone to sign, which would require that the Department of Community Health select at least two insurers. It probably would be best if we required three or four, but we are requiring that the state provide at least two insurers in the state health benefit plan so people can have choice. And you know, at this point, what we are confronted with in the state health benefit plan that Blue Cross Blue Shield is offering is high deductibles. We see deductibles going up two and three times what it was previously under the former plan. High deductibles and less choice. And it's a lot of controversy. There's a court case going on. And we'll see how that plays out. The lawyers for United Healthcare are accusing, they're using a very strong phrase, and I will quote it, state-sponsored bid rigging, end of quote. And we need to get to the bottom of that. We need to answer that question. Was it, in fact, that state-sponsored bid rigging? The people of the state of Georgia deserve to know whether your friends get treated better than the state employees, better than teachers, at a time when we're telling teachers we're going to put $550 million in the budget so we can help you, although that $550 million we should remember and we should educate our constituents on is not earmarked for what? Teacher pay raises. It could be used for any reason that a local board sees fit. And you can bet that some of that money is not going to get to teachers. So at this point, this new plan is effectively a pay cut for teachers. It is effectively a pay cut. More money out of the pockets of teachers translates into a pay cut for those teachers. So you're putting money in one pocket and taking it out of the other pocket. I will make this piece of legislation available to any and all of you who would like to sign on so we could tell the teachers of the state of Georgia, we believe in the free market, we believe in choice, we believe that you should not be constrained by just one carrier. You ought to have a choice among many carriers. This is a very serious situation. There's uproar throughout the state. People, there's grassroots organizing going on, and we need to do the right thing. The governor says he's going to offer a change of some sort. I'm glad he's listening to the people. I'm glad he's listening to those legislators who are demanding a change. You know, state-sponsored bid rigging is not what we need here in the state of Georgia. And by the way, that comes from the governor's own lawyer. You know, so this is not a, when someone charges state-sponsored bid rigging, this is not coming from a Democrat. This is coming from the governor's own lawyer. He needs to heed that language. He needs to understand what's going on. He needs to understand that the people of the state of Georgia need relief. Middle-class families, teachers need relief. Mr. President, I yield the well and look forward to getting response. The signatures, we'd like as many signatures as we can get before we drop this bill this afternoon. Thank you.
Chair recognizes the senator from the 54th for a point of personal privilege, and then the senator from the 45th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, I rise, frankly, in response to my friend from the 39th, the minority whip, to clarify what I consider to be a really fundamental misunderstanding of the nature of employer-sponsored insurance. I think it is really reckless and dangerous for any of us to perpetuate the ignorance in the marketplace about how employer-sponsored plans work. It is a myth, at best, possibly an illusion, to say that using multiple administrators for a single plan constitutes choice of insurance. The plan is the state health benefit plan. It is an employer-sponsored plan. All dollars are state dollars. It is the same way that most major employers around the nation handle their insurance. So when we have two administrators, there is not two insurance. There are no two insurance plans in those sorts of situations. I do not oppose that situation. If the State Board of Community Health wants to do that in the future, return to that model, I'm certainly comfortable with their decision. But it is reckless for us to tell people that they had choice of insurance. No, they had state insurance when we had two administrators. There's a fundamental difference there, and we need to be honest about it. There was only one insurance plan last year, and there's only one insurance plan this year. The structure of that plan is set and decided on by the state board. Now, I know there's a lot of concern. I share the optimism and excitement of my friend from the 39th that there are going to be adjustments made, hopefully mid-year, in-year adjustments, plan amendments, to ease some of the concerns that our employees have expressed. But it is not accurate to say that providing two administrators, the administrator's function is to administratively implement the plan that the employer funds. These are not insurance company dollars. These are state dollars. So it is important that we know the difference and that our constituents know and understand the difference. It is not fair to mislead Georgians about the nature of employer-sponsored insurance. It creates confusion, and it's not fair. So I ask that as we go forward, everybody understand that we're not talking about a choice between insurers. The insurer is the state of Georgia. The administrator is who you call and whose name is on your benefits card. Mr. President, I would yield the well. Thank you.
Chair recognizes the senator from the 45th.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, on a very, very cold winter morning. I appreciate being able to speak, and I could not agree more with the senator from Dalton with his rebuttal. And having been in medicine my whole life since I was 18 years old and knowing health care, I agree wholeheartedly with his comments. I rise before you today to let you know that the Senate Health and Human Service Committee had a study committee that met this summer about hospitals and independent doctors, independent physicians in the state of Georgia. That study committee will be released today at 10 o'clock. We have had 5 meetings. Those meetings have taken place in Gainesville, Macon, Rome, and Alpharetta. And that report will be released. And I rise just to say thank you. It's a very contentious issue. There's just a few independent docs left in the state of Georgia. Some of those you may recognize as the Harbin Clinic, the Longstreet Clinic in Gainesville. There's a big clinic in Macon and the Coastal Georgia Clinic that's in Savannah, Georgia. And I just say thank you for the 3 different hospital associations who have worked on this study committee and the independent doctors in Georgia, how much we appreciate the collegiality and the camaraderie and coming together on this particular issue. The issue is not resolved. It will continue to be debated, but I just want to express our appreciation. Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 42nd for a point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President, colleagues. I have great respect for the senator from Dalton and his knowledge of employer benefit plans, but let me tell you what I see. I see that I used to be able to pick my pharmacy in the way that I wanted to under the state employee health benefit plan. My wife, who's a teacher, used to be able to do that. We used to have a variety of choices as members of the state employee health benefit plan. I think that's the danger that we have. That's what teachers are calling us complaining about. It's not single administrator, multiple administrators, all of this stuff. It's kind of hocus pocus. People's concern is that the benefits have gotten much worse, dramatically worse. And when I get a letter that says, congratulations, you have a new pharmacy plan, I know I'm in trouble. And I got that letter, and I thought, oh man, this is a mess. And that's why teachers around the state are going crazy about it, is because it's getting worse. And if you can't recognize that, if we can't say there is a difference between having different choices, then we're not hearing what people are saying. Now, the other piece of this, and I don't know the facts. I don't know the facts. But I know that the governor's lawyer is saying that the process for selecting this contract is an embarrassment to our state and our governor. That's the governor's own lawyer, Randy Evans. And so when those things are going on and you've got teachers out in the field trying to do their work for their children, for our children, for the future of our state, and we're not responding to their needs and their actual concerns, that's not right. That's all I'm saying. The teacher in my family and I, you know, all of us sitting back here just minutes ago talking about what happened to our benefits. That's what it is. Just listen to people. Understand what it is. It's not that there's no difference. I know that's not what the senator meant, but this is what we're talking about, is getting together with people who are suffering now under a new plan, acting like we're giving them a pay increase when in fact we're charging them way more for worse insurance. It's a failure of listening is what it is, and I just hope that it stops. Thanks.
Chair recognizes Senator of the 41st, point of personal privilege.
I too wanted to rise because I think there might have been some confusion either in what some people heard or what was intended. We know in the past we've had multiple administrators, and we know plans can have multiple administrators. We know plans can have various options. Under the one single administrator we got now, there's 3 options at least on your variable levels of insurance depending on what you want to pay. You can also, as an employer, have various administrators that offer different selections and options that vary from each other. That is up to the employer and, in conjunction with the administrator, trying to decide what's best for the populace they serve, their employees. Our state has not shown a commitment over the last few years to their employees. It has shown a plan that has reduced benefits greatly and has increased costs to the employees. It has been one that has reduced both the amount of administrators and the options available. The point of the bill is mainly to bring notice to you and allow the citizens of Georgia to know that we care, that there are options, that there are quality health insurance programs available, because we are really getting to the point that retaining quality state employees is harder and harder. We've seen their pension plans diminished, and we've seen a tremendous thing over the last decade eradicating the kind of health benefits that they expect and deserve. We know in the state budget, the state health plan has $281 million, I think, in the big budget saved to the state. We're paying less, our employees are getting less and paying more. We've got to resolve ourselves to make a commitment to the employees of the state to appreciate them and to provide them with health care coverage that can save their lives, protect their families, and bring the kind of quality of life that we would expect for ourselves. I hope you will let the senator's bill be heard, because the greatest tragedy is when we have bills like his that aren't even heard in committee. So whether you decide you want to support it or not, I commend to you that you should allow it to be heard and discussed and debated in the future. Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 35th, point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to say that I took my pen out when the senator from the 39th stood here and told me about this bill, because since November of 2012, my husband left to go get a new kidney, and he could not get it. He had open heart surgery and a list of other things. Now he's a double amputee. He has not come home since he left there. We had United Healthcare, the state insurance. Due to no fault of my own, I had to change to this new insurance. And when he left the hospital after 55 days, which was the day before we started this session, with a broken back, he had to go to a nursing home. But they told me I had to pay the deductible before he could go. We've had the insurance all these years for the state. Well, $2,000 before he could even walk into the nursing home that he's been going back and forth into for 2 years, a year and a half now. So I say to you, we need to do something about this, or I'm gonna have to stand on the corner. You'll see me with a little cup just to take care of my husband and my family. So at this point, I hope we find some way. If you don't want to sign his bill, get something, and let's do something for the teachers and for the state employees. Because it's a travesty that if you have a loved one, that you have to go through this, and then you have to cough up money just to try to take care of them. Mr. President, I yield the well, and I hope that everyone listened. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Chair recognizes Senator from the 40th, point of personal privilege.
First of all, to the Senator from the 35th, I think everybody in this room empathizes with you, believe me. So please believe that on a bipartisan basis on that. I think we need to correct a few facts here. I've been in the insurance business for 40 years. Number one, my colleague from DeKalb County talking about the governor's lawyer. The governor's lawyer also represents United Healthcare folks. These are the people that lost the administration of the plan. So he is making his comments really in the context of representing United Healthcare. So let's get that straight, number one. Number two, for those of us in the private sector, what the state employees are now facing is no different what a lot of our fellow employees and our jobs have been facing for the last 5 years. We've all seen rising co-pays, we've all seen rising deductibles, and it's a fact of life. That's where we are today with health insurance. And believe me, going forward, and this is the important point, I want you all to remember this. This is just the beginning of rising costs. I'll close with this argument. And I want you to watch what happens in the course of the next year. Welcome to Obamacare. Thank you.
You. I don't see your light. Chair recognizes Senator from the 26th, point of personal privilege.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, I'm part of the problem. Let me tell you about our health insurance. When I got to the legislature, I was 24 years old, good and healthy, playing semi-pro football, didn't have a problem. Now I'm 63 and got all kinds of problems. Diabetic, blood pressure problem. I have to depend on my health insurance. Now, the strange thing from United Healthcare and the Cigna to one a vendor. 2 years ago, I had a problem because of being a diabetic. I take two insulins, Levemir, which is a slow-acting insulin, and then Novolog, which is used on a sliding scale based on what your sugar is or your blood sugar. United Healthcare said you're gonna have to take Humalog. Well, I called my doctor because I go to a diabetic specialist. He said, well, David, the Humalog is supposed to do exactly what the Novolog does. So he wrote the prescription, and I went on Humalog. I was sitting over across the hall one day, and my blood sugar had gone up to about 275. So I went to the restroom and took some Humalog, and it was supposed to get my blood sugar down. Well, I took 75 units, and it didn't get down below 165. So I called my diabetic doctor, and he told me, "Say when you get out, you just need to come straight on to my office. I'll stay open for you." Got there, and he ran the test and everything. He said, "What happened is, it's not working for you. For some reason, the Humalog is not working to get your blood sugar down like it needs to be. A1C was up. Blood sugar was up." So he said, well, you probably will not have a problem because now we just go prior approval. We've run all the tests and everything, and we'll submit it. Well, United Healthcare came back and said, look, either you take Humalog or you die. That's basically what they said, because they said they weren't going to pay for Novolog. Well, it's a good thing old David had enough to go to the drugstore and buy his medication and pay 100% of it. Well, right before we changed insurance, United Healthcare started paying for Navalog. It was a blessing. I get a notice the other day on a formulary list from Blue Cross Blue Shield that tells me that it's going to be Humalog. Now, I've got to try to go back through the same thing I went before, knowing that it just don't work for David Lucas. That is what the problem is. And then the last part is this. The legislature messed up the health insurance plan. There was $765 million in what we call the health insurance trust fund. About $300 million of it was state employees money, and about $400 million is basically what the state had put in. During the recession, you took the $765 million, you spent it, and you hadn't been able to put it back. And so if we had a catastrophic event over the state, we don't have enough money in the fund to take care of state employees. That's what the problem is. So they're trying to gin it up. The premiums are up, your copay is up. But the biggest problem is, I went to the doctor the other day, and I go to a podiatrist. Podiatrist not in, I guess what you call network. I've been going to the podiatrist for 8 years, insurance been paying for it. I get over there, I got to pay her $80 to go in there. While I'm in there, a retired school teacher said that she went to a doctor to get a physical, and he wouldn't accept Blue Cross Blue Shield, and she'd been going to him for 10 years. We got some problems. They should have been worked out. I understand we're talking about if we're going to save money, but ladies and gentlemen, when we did the enrollment, I'm going to give you a good example. I called over and over, and my call got dropped. Over and over, and the call got dropped. And in the last week of enrollment, I ended up having several deaths in the family, was out of state. Got back, called them, finally got somebody on the phone. They sent me the form to appeal. They stuck me in the bronze plan, the bottom plan, $37.5 out of pocket before they pay on your deductible. And what I was paying with United Healthcare, I can get in the top plan with Blue Cross Blue Shield and still save money, and they won't even let me in the plan. There's something wrong with this insurance. Now, somebody cut a deal. Somebody cut a deal. You got one vendor. Somebody cut a deal. Now, who cut the deal? On state employees. So I ask you, let's look at it. It is upon us to get it straight. Not the Board of Community Health. They don't pay the bill. We appropriate the money. And if we appropriate the money, we ought to have some say-so about what kind of health insurance we have.
So, all right. Chair recognizes Senator from the 33rd first, 33rd, for a point of personal privilege. Is it? And then Senator from the 32nd, then Senator from 36th.
Pay no attention to the meeting behind me. It's not going on. Let me say this, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I have heard the word Obamacare mentioned with such disrespect in the last several years to the point that I'm sick of it. Now, I want to tell you, William Jefferson Clinton was my president. George Herbert Walker Bush was my president. George W. Bush was my president. I've always referred to him as the president of the United States. But there seems to be some underlying factor that is either hard to define, or maybe it's too easy to define, which is my fear more than anything else. Let me tell you, I'm going to get to health care and about that, but I want to tell you, the one thing you've got to remember is the president is the president of the United States. He was elected twice. He wasn't afraid to go after our enemies. And even Gates says it was one of the most courageous decisions anybody had ever made with a 40% chance of attacking our enemy. Gaddafi no longer lives. The bottom line is let's get past trying to sneer when we talk about the President of the United States. Now, you could have called it Romney Care in Massachusetts because that's exactly what it was. Never explained it. I just want to say this. The courts will find out what went on as far as the way it was bid and if there was anything that was done wrong. But we will know within the next year, as people are tracking it, how many benefits and how much money the state employees will lose, or if they will not lose, over the next year. We can track it, and we can find out, and we will. So the bottom line is that it's not like we're blind. People are watching. Nobody's in a room by themselves thinking nobody sees them. The bottom line is we are watching, and we are looking, and we're going to count the monies together and see how our employees and our teachers fared at the end of this coming year. And I don't know what that story, but I got a feeling we're going to have a kind of a lump in our chest because we're not going to do as well. And I'm sorry about that because it affects so many people. I'm also sorry that we're not involving ourselves with $300 million to help poor folks. And I just don't understand. I can't put my finger on why that is. A lot of the governor's doing I like. A lot is doing I not like. That hadn't changed in 200 years. We're always going to have that, two parties and two opinions. But I think it's time to show everybody the respect they're due. And the President of the United States is one of them. I admire him. But I thank you for listening to my little opinion. I appreciate you.
Chair recognizes Senator from 32nd.
We're here to talk about a couple things. One is the health plan. The other is the Affordable Care Act that I think is the Unaffordable Care Act. But I do want to make a point of clarification is our president, President Obama, does call it himself Obamacare. You can come to my office and watch the videos a number of times. He proclaims it Obamacare, so I'll call it the Affordable Care Act. It really doesn't matter what it's called. It really what matters is what it does. First off, it's economically unstable. Fiscally, it's fiscally irresponsible. Third is it's harmful to hardworking Americans. It's unwise and not responsible to exchange 29 uninsured Americans for a flawed program that costs 10 times more to the people, the hardworking taxpayers of America, but moreover to the people of America who are substantially hurt by this irresponsible program that we've been talking about now for many years. Insurance costs are skyrocketing. The cost is directly related to the Affordable Care Act. Everyone's personal information is at risk. Let me repeat, everybody's personal information is at risk. We conducted a number of hearings this summer. The information is being stolen off the website, the formal website. The security information is flawed. I've talked to security experts that create these websites, and they say the architecture is flawed. It needs to be created over to protect your information. I've had a number of calls, almost zero information is transferred from the website to an insurance company that you thought you signed up for, which means you thought you had insurance and you don't. Last night I spoke to a lady who had this problem. It took her 6 weeks to get out of the program. 6 weeks. I'd suggest this is very similar to the experience many Georgians are having with Medicaid and will continue to have with Medicaid, which is hard access, difficult access to doctors, low pay for the physicians that are providing this care, extremely poor access to doctors, not because the doctors want to provide it, but because the system is fundamentally flawed. The new cost to this program this year is approximately $352 million to Georgians. It's about a $1,000 additional tax to the people of the state of Georgia. I think it's wrong. I think our state health benefit plan employees are only experiencing one thing. They're experiencing what many people in Medicaid in Georgia are experiencing today, which is a fundamentally flawed, irresponsible program that needs to be transformed, and we need to throw out, repeal the Affordable and Unaffordable Care Act, Obamacare, whatever you want to call it, the program that's in place. Remember, many of y'all are getting for what you asked for. This is not what a lot of us asked for, but many of us are getting what we asked for. I'm not one, so I'd say welcome to the Unaffordable Care Act. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 36th.
Good morning, colleagues. Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to take issue with some of the comments we've heard from the well and to shed a little light on this subject matter. Appreciate your attention. What we're faced with in this state is a trajectory that didn't just start yesterday. And that is that our public employees, our school teachers, those who labor in this building working with us to process all this paper and move our process along and staff us, those across the great state that are providing services in our parks and recreation centers, those that are caring for our wildlife and conservation, those that are working in the Department of Agriculture, our largest industry in the state, our most bringing in the most money. All of these people have been poorly served by events that didn't start in January with a new healthcare setup that we've got going. Most of them haven't had raises in 7 years. A lot of them won't get raises in this budget either. As Senator Carter has pointed out, the median wage, the average family wage in Georgia, took a $6,000 hit, more than $6,000, over $6,600 from 10 years ago. These are real people. These are our constituents. These are Georgians. We're going in the wrong direction. And this debate over health care and what's happened to the school teachers' health insurance is part of the wrong direction in which we're going. Now, you've heard comments up here raising up the Affordable Care Act. I've never seen such a classic case of changing the subject. President Obama didn't have a thing to do with what contract got made with which insurance company for our public employee benefits. Didn't have a thing to do with it, folks. Of course, the federal act does provide that you can't block people anymore, you can't knock people out because they have a pre-existing condition. And it does provide that children up to 26, or young people, young adults, can stay on their parents' policy. And it does provide for covering birth control and contraceptive services so that people can plan their families. It does an awful lot. It does an awful lot. But it sure didn't sign a contract with one insurance company in this state to provide our public employees with a health insurance. Didn't do that. So you can stand up here and talk all day about the Affordable Care Act if what you want to do is dodge what's happening with our state health insurance plan. But I'll tell you, the folks, now I've talked to people right in this building who rely on, work hard every day, show up, do their job. We rely on them, and yet we sat by while a deal got cut here that does not serve our teachers and our public employees. And right in this building, I have spoken with state employees, people we rely on, backbone in this Capitol, behind the scenes, moving this work, staffing us, running these agencies, delivering every day. And I'll just take an example. One person, single mother, battling cancer, because of the change in the health insurance policy that went into effect January 1, each paycheck that she gets, her take-home pay is cut by $80 each pay period. That's $160 a month. I know a lot of average families that face some hard decisions if they get a $160 a month cut in their pay, in their paycheck. Doing the same work, maybe working a little more. Our productivity is up, but our median income for an average Georgia family is down. So this isn't an idle debate. It's about real people. Why do you think teachers across the state are organizing and actually have put together an organization to look into this and to address this pressing issue of health insurance? And it's not the Affordable Care Act, folks. It's the Georgia State Health Insurance Plan. So let's lay aside any more talk about how the president and the federal health plan is messing up our state health benefits plan. No, instead, in an effort to save money, we push down on the people that can least afford to have money taken out of their pocket. That's what's happened here, and it's a genuine problem. It is up to us to address it. We need to stop pushing around the families of public employees and school teachers who already are underpaid, already wages stagnant, not suffering without any salary increases to even keep up with the cost of living. And you know when the insult started is when right out here in the parking lot, they told everybody, we're gonna double what you pay when you come to work down here. You come to work for state government every day and you pay a parking fee. But you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna double that and you have no recourse. You pay it or you don't have a parking place. And that came straight out of everybody's check that parked across the street. That was a pay cut, folks. That was a pay cut, an unnecessary pay cut, unwarranted pay cut. And there wasn't anybody that could talk any sense into the top boys that did that. So years ago, we delivered that insult or stood by while it was delivered. And now today, we're here in session in a state that has just kicked around public employees, kicked around public school teachers by damaging fundamentally the health insurance coverage, and then want to stand up here and blame the President of the United States. Beats all I ever saw. Tell you what we should do is go on and expand Medicaid. Now that would bring in $33 billion into this state's economy. It would create 77,000 jobs in the next 10 years, and it would cover more than 500,000 Georgians who can't get insurance now, don't have insurance, can't afford it, and won't be able to get it until this state steps up to the plate like Republican governors have done all over the country and expanded Medicaid. Build our economy, grow our economy, deliver better health care, rebuild our health delivery infrastructure, fund the hospitals. They've got patients showing up that don't have any coverage. Those who are insured eat that bill. So we could do some great things on health care in this state. We ought to step up to the plate and get in the game and do the right thing. Thank you for your attention.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 19th on a point of personal privilege, and this will be our last point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President. I've been around the Senate a number of years. I was here when the Republicans were in the minority, and even back then, health care costs and premiums were going up. They continue to go up. I've sat in on several conference committees on the budget when we'd get word from the Department of Community Health that we had $200 million in additional claims that we didn't anticipate. Folks, the state pays the bill, as the senator in the back of the room has said. The state pays the bill. We hire these folks on contract to process the claims. The claims are what causes the problems and the cost of health care. One of the things we've done in a positive way is to go to health reimbursement accounts so that if you're not a person that gets sick, you can actually build a fund if you don't go to the doctor often. This is great for young folks that are working for the state. I want to take just an opportunity, though, to thank the governor for putting in money to cover autism in the state health benefit plan. Every kid that has autism
that gets treated has a 50% chance of getting back on grade level. If these kids don't get on grade level, they wind up being in special ed classes, often for the rest of their time in public school. This is extremely expensive to the state. And for those kids that don't get help, the chances of them being on Medicaid and public assistance for the rest of their life is significant. So I just want to thank the governor. To me, autism is something now one out of every 55 boys are autistic. One out of every 80 girls are autistic. These are numbers that continue to grow, and the state has finally said, you know, this is not this, and I voted against many mandates. This is something that ought to be covered. And I hope the Senate and the Lieutenant Governor will look hard at passing the bill on autism that deals with private insurance. These are companies that actually pay, these are people that actually pay premiums to cover what ought to be covered. You know, as a business person, when I buy coverage for my employees, and I'm extremely worried about what's going to happen when the Affordable Health Care Act forces me to do this, I'm doing it now. It's going to be much more expensive for me, but when I buy coverage, I'm not looking for just the cheapest coverage. I'm looking for the best coverage for the money, just like I would an automobile or anything else. But I just want to take just the time to say, Governor, thank you for covering what we ought to cover with those state employees who have autistic children. Thank you.
All right, is everybody on the floor today going to have a point of personal privilege? Senator from the 38th, didn't you already speak? You didn't? All right, Chair recognized Senator from 38. If you would, just wait for one moment. Let me get the doctor of the day. He has been patiently waiting and doing a remarkable job doing so. I apologize. Let me recognize the senator from the 32nd to recognize the doctor of the day.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm privileged to come to you the third time this year with the doctor of the day. We have some great physicians in the 32nd district, and it's my honor and privilege to introduce you to Dr. Negner, who is at Wellstar Kennistone Hospital. He's an internal medicine specialist. He received his degree in India. He's got a tremendous background and resume, and we really appreciate, Doctor, you being here today. We know where to find him down in the medical office. And Doctor, thank you once again. It's an honor to have you here. And please, Senators, please give Dr. Negner a warm Senate welcome. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. It's a privilege to be the doctor of the day, and hopefully you won't need to see me at the medical station, and I'm glad to meet everyone, and thank you all for your service, and I guess we are united by a common goal of public service and hope to be here in the future as well. And I also represent the Medical Association of Georgia and Georgia Association of Physicians of Indian Origin. And again, it's an honor and privilege to be here. Thank you.
Now, Chair recognized, Senator 38.
Thank you, Mr. President, colleagues. This has been a very interesting morning. I think we have had an opportunity to air all of our points of personal privileges, which is what it's all about, being able to say what it is that's on your mind and what you feel, and have your colleagues respect you and listen to how you feel about these things. As I was listening to some of the comments, what really touched me was that we are talking about our constituents. We are talking about state employees. We are talking about people who, as has already been stated, have had decreases in their salaries, and this particular health administrator's plan is not going to do anything to continue to uplift the people that work hardest for us and that we are entrusted to make good decisions for. All we're asking is that we give people choices. I've said before from the well, it's difficult once you've given people choices to no longer give them these choices. That is a very hard thing. We need to be about looking at what's good for the state employees as well as what's good for all of the state, all of the individuals in the state. I think we will all admit that there are concerns with what has occurred. We're not sure how it occurred, and I'm sure we'll get to the bottom of it. But the bottom line is to help the state employees, the teachers, everyone that comes under this plan, take a good look at it, give us choices, be able to determine that that's best plan for them. I think when we look at what we've done at the state with Blue Cross Blue Shield, we will find that we have not saved the amount of money that it was promised. I think it was said we was gonna save about $1.5 billion, and no, it's really about $200 million. So we've taken choices away from employees as a result of just trying to save money. We have options. That's what this session's gonna be about. The bills that we pass will give us options, hopefully to raise revenues in the state. And with those options, we can restore some things. So I'm asking my colleagues to keep an open mind when it comes time to reviewing the options that come before us that can ease some of these situations. Take a close look at it and think about the people that you're actually representing. Think about the options that we have before us that could raise revenues to be able to not continue to cut, but to actually help people in our state. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Chair recognizes the Senator from the 22nd.
Point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, I rise to speak on a point of personal privilege. We've heard a lot of robust discussion on this morning, and we spent the last several days starting this weekend and making our way to Monday, and in some cases even Tuesday and other days, celebrating the life and the legacy of one Dr. Martin Luther King, the distinguished son of this great state. As we talk about nonviolence and the things that we've endeared ourselves to, a day of service and not a day off. The very heart of that is that we have an opportunity as elected officials, and I applaud the governor for the things that he has done to help move this great state forward. I am reminded of these words, and I think they ring true because I've got almost 2,000 teachers in Augusta, Richmond County that I represent who have been furloughed for 9 days for the last 5 years, and in two-parent families where both of them are teachers, it cuts into their pocketbook. As elected officials, we have a responsibility, as Dr. King indicated. Cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? And vanity comes along and asks the question, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? There comes a time when one must take a position that is neither safe, nor politic, nor popular, but he must do it because conscience tells him it is right. I think it's right that we're having robust conversation, but I also think it's right that we look for opportunities to help everybody in this great state, and in particular those teachers and others who are part of the state health benefit plan. I am confident that our governor, in his wisdom, will look for opportunities to help solve this problem. I look forward to rolling up my sleeves and being a part of that solution process. But for those of us who are in this distinguished chamber, we can move beyond the rhetoric and the politics of this issue and remind ourselves that we've got Georgians, good family members, that we have a vested responsibility to look for solutions to solve the issues of our day. And the issues of our day is that I've got almost 2,000 teachers who've been furloughed over the last 4 years, 9 days a year. And we need to solve this problem. We need to solve this problem beyond politics and go and focus on people ticks. And those are the ones that we've been vested to look after. You have them in your districts. I agree with the senator from the 19th and applaud him for his statements concerning autism as a challenge that not only has he been fighting for, but I have as well. And so this morning, I hope these words ring true and sincere in the hearts of all of you who are listening. This is our issue. And as Georgians who care about other good Georgians, we need to solve this issue and make a place of stability for our teachers and others who make this state great and what it is. Thank you, Mr. President.
Are there any? Secretary, read a resolution.
Senate Resolution 776 by Senator Thompson of the 14th. A resolution commending Bobby Cox and recognizing February 10th, 2014 as Bobby Cox Day and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 778 by Senator Harbison of the 15th and others. A resolution recognizing and commending the American Legion Post 29 Service Officer Ken Buchel and Melody Unger for helping a homeless man, John Chambers, and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 779 by Senator Dugan of the 30th and others. A resolution congratulating Mr. and Mrs. Harold Peacock on the occasion of their 50th wedding anniversary and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 780 by Senator Jeffries of the 17th and others. A resolution honoring the life and memory of Roger Sheridan and other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 781 by Senator Jeffries of the 17th. A resolution recognizing the importance of family and consumer sciences education and February 19, 2014 as Family Consumer Sciences Day at the state capitol and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair is none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 784 by Senator Bethel of the 54th. A resolution recognizing and commending the Northwest Whitfield County High School Lady Bruins softball team on the 2013 GHSA Class 4A State Championship and other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair is none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 785 by Senator Thompson of the 14th and others. A resolution commending Thomas Michael Tom Glaving and recognizing February 18, 2014 as Tom Glaving Day at the state capitol and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none. The resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 786 by Senator C of the 34th and others. A resolution recognizing and commending June R. Wood on the occasion of her retirement and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none. The resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 787 by Senator Ginn of the 47th and others. A resolution recognizing January 28, 2014 as Tourism, Hospitality, and Arts Day at the state capitol and commending the tourism industry of Georgia and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none. The resolution is adopted.
That completes the order, Mr. President.
Are there any motions to withdraw or commit? We have a local consent calendar that's before you. Secretary will read.
House Bill 768, a bill to be entitled an act to amend an act providing to supplement salary of the judge of the Superior Court of the Cherokee Judicial Circuit approved March 22, 1963, as amended particularly by act approved April 25, 2002, so as to change the supplement to be paid to each judge of such circuit to provide for related matters to provide an effective date to repeal conflicting laws and for other purposes. The Committee on the Senate on State and Local Government Operations recommends this bill do pass. Senator Ligon, Chairman.
Mr. Secretary, are there any objections filed to any of the bills on the local consent calendar?
Mr. President, there are no objections filed with the Secretary's office.
Is there objection to agreeing to report of committee on state and local governmental operations, which favorable passage of the bill on the local consent calendar? Chairs none. The report of committee is agreed to, and the question is on the passage of the bills on the local consent calendar. All of those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Voting on the local consent calendar. On the passage of the local consent calendar, the yeas are 51 and the nays are 0. This bill having received requisite constitutional majority, or these bills, are therefore adopted. Secretary will read House Bill, excuse me, Senate Bill 297.
Senate Bill 297 by Senator Miller of the 49th. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Article 2 of Chapter 5 of Title 21 of the OCGA related to campaign contributions as required for the filing of notices of intention to accept campaign contributions by county and municipal candidates to provide that certain candidates may file notice of intent not to accept more than $2,500 or expend more than $2,500 in the election and be relieved of filing campaign finance disclosure reports and for other purposes. The Senate Committee on Ethics recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senator Jaffray, 17th Chairman. Senate Ethics Committee offers the following substitute to SB 297. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 5 of Title 21 of the OGGA relating to ethics and government so as to change the assignment of the Georgia Government Transparency and Campaign Fund Commission for budgetary purposes from the Secretary of State to the State Accounting Office to provide for the filing of notices of intention to accept campaign contributions by county and municipal candidates to provide that certain candidates may file a notice of intent not to accept more than $2,500 or expend more than $2,500 in the election and be relieved of filing campaign finance disclosure reports and for other purposes. Senator Henson of the 41st offers the following amendment. Amendment the Senate Ethics Committee substitute to SB 297 by striking State Accounting Office on line 4 and inserting in lieu thereof Office of the Attorney General and by striking State Accounting Office on line 21 and inserting in lieu thereof Office of the Attorney General. Senator Miller of the 49th and Senator Chance of the 16th offered the following amendment to SB 297 by deleting in its entirety Section 1 lines 12 through 21. By amending line 30 to delete the term public officer and replace with candidate. By amending line 40 to delete the word report and replace with declaration of intention. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 49th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have bring before the Senate Senate Bill 297, and this bill really intends to clarify the General Assembly's initial intent with House Bill 143 from the 2013 legislative session. The bill was intended to exempt local officials from filing campaign disclosure reports if they were not raising nor spending more than $2,500. This is going to clarify for the local officials who has to provide a report and who does not. It's a real simple bill. It's very narrow in scope. It is just cleaning up something we did handle last year. At this time, I'd like to also offer an amendment to the bill that'll do three things. It will delete in its entirety, Section 1. In Section 2, it'll change the words public officer to candidate. And in Section 2, it will also change on line 40 the word report to declaration of intent. And that's the bill, Mr. President.
Any questions? Senator from the 26th, you wishing to ask a question? You recognize to do so.
Gentleman in the wheel, can you tell me the rationale of not going to the state ethics where we deal with it all the time and now you're going to take it to the Attorney General's office?
That's in Section 1, sir, we've corrected that.
Is this the amendment that's being offered, sir? This is a different
one. Right.
The amendment you're looking at is amendment authored by your minority leader.
The amendments are coming out as we speak. I beg your pardon, sir.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 39th.
Will the Senator yield?
Certainly.
I want to clarify the in the change, not the Section 1 change. I think we're getting amendments on the amendment deals with the concern I had about that. But on the other part of that amendment, what is the language change relative to declaration of intent? Can you explain that?
If you will look at line 40, where it says report, we're changing that to declaration of intent to the commission, not later than 10 days after the close of the reporting period.
Okay. Will the senator further yield?
Certainly.
And let me give you a scenario. If a official receives a contribution under $2,500, are you saying that that public official does not need to, if he does this, will not need to report that?
That's correct.
That
not
contribution?
This, July 31 would not have to correct to, excuse me, January 31 would not have to report that. That's correct.
On January 31?
Yes, sir.
Will the senator further yield?
Certainly.
If that's, if that elected official receives a donation after January 31, will they then have to report that under this?
No, sir, not if he's not going to collect more than $2,500.
Okay, so we're taking, okay.
That was the original intent of the bill last year. Yes, sir.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Chair recognizes Senator from 33rd for a question.
Senator Yield?
Certainly.
Senator, let me ask you, the net effect of your First Amendment that you're presenting is to take it back out of the substitute and to let it fall back into the Secretary of State's office
that's
for
correct.
Administrative purposes. I'm not sure that's good. Let me ask you one other one. There's some listings here, and when you list candidates for public office, you're in the code section, you list F and G and on page 2, and then in the section 3, you cite another code section by letter that defines those public officials. Those four public officials, as defined in that code, could you tell me who they are?
No, sir, I cannot offhand. Beg your pardon.
Well, you will not.
There were local school boards, local officials.
Right. You have one more question?
Yes, sir.
Does it affect members of the General Assembly?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 42nd for a question. Waves it off. No further questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 39th. 39th, your light's on. Are you wishing to speak? You're recognized to do so. Oh.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, I rise to speak to the bill. I am glad to see that there are amendments. The First and Second Amendment will take care of one of the issues that concerns many of us, and that is the transfer of the Ethics Commission to the State Accounting Office. The issue that I have is another issue. I understand that the issue of not having to report under $2,500 was an issue in last year's state ethics bill. There were a lot of things in that bill. There were some things, admittedly, that were much more sizable than this issue, and we debated those big issues. We didn't debate this issue so much. But it is an issue that we need to give some attention to for this reason. Not reporting contributions $2,500 or less sounds reasonable to the public official. To the public official, people like us who say, you know, we're not collecting a lot of money. We don't want to be inundated with paperwork. But there's a reason for that paperwork. And the people out there, the people we serve, who vote for us, our constituents, I think would take another point of view that you're getting money, we want to know who's giving you money, and you ought to report it. It's just that simple scenario. If there's a zoning on the local level, on a city or county level, if there's a zoning application, and members of that commission or that city council get a $500 contribution, guess what? People want to know that. They want to know it as soon as they can. They want to know who gave the money, how much it was. And we might say $2,500 or less is a small amount of money. Well, influence peddling is done with contributions of less than $2,500. Let's be real about it. So I am not going to support, I'm going to support the amendments, but I am not going to support the bill for that reason, that our constituents should know who's giving us money, when they're giving us money, and they should know it as soon as possible. It shouldn't be delayed. Mr. President, I'll yield the well unless there are questions that I'll be glad to take.
There are questions. Chair recognizes Senator from the ninth for a question.
Nope.
Yes, sir.
Is it your position that Senate Bill 297 is written to say that people who get less than $2,500 don't have to report?
It is my position that by virtue of the questions that I asked the author from the 49th, that that's the case. Now, if you can clarify it, that's fine, but anything that interferes with the public's ability to know who's giving us money, when they're giving us money, is, I think, in, you know, when is very important, because a constituent can then determine when that giving is done in proximity to any action that that public official takes, that elected official takes.
Is it not true that the bill we passed last year already exempts people from giving $2,500? This does not do that. This just clarifies some of the prior law. The law in effect today, doesn't it already say that local officials who get less than $2,500 don't have to report?
Well, let me say this. If it says that, I don't agree with it. If this doesn't correct it, I disagree with it. I'm not going to vote for it. You can vote any way you see fit, Senator.
Senator from the 29th, you wish to question or speak? Chair recognizes Senator from the 29th for a question.
Will the Senator yield?
I most certainly will.
Is it the Senator's understanding that the $2,500 limit is the aggregate raised for the entire cycle, not per contribution?
Yes, I'm aware of that.
Okay.
Yes,
just wanted
sir.
To make that clear.
Senator from the 41st, are you wishing to question or speak? Okay, no further questions, Senator.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 41st. Speak to the bill.
Couple things, Mr. President. First of all, at the appropriate time, I'm supportive of the senators from the 49th and 16th Amendment to strike Section 1, and I will, at the proper time, ask the President to unanimous consent to reorder the amendments, allow that one to be taken first. If it passes, I withdraw amendment that I have submitted to the body. Second of all, I'd like to commend to you that as we work on these important issues, we shouldn't forget the other dialogue with ethics that have gone on in the past, but for too many times and too often is muted. We have several bills in the hopper right now concerning ethics. One I could have tried to amend here today, but it would have been long and it would have held the bill over. That's to make sure that we have appointments that create an independent ethics commission. We need to make sure the people that are supervising our election officials, these people that do the financial reports, are being looked at by an independent source. So I hope that our other ethics legislation will be looked at as in a fair way. I commend the majority party for not engrossing this bill. I think that should only be done in rare cases, and quite frankly,
I haven't found one of those rare cases I found acceptable. So I commend them in not engrossing this legislation, and appreciate your consideration of the amendment from the senator from the 49th and the 16th. In the appropriate time, I would, I'll withdraw my own. Thank you.
Question is on the adoption of Amendment 2. Is there objection to Amendment 2? Without objection, Amendment number 2 has been adopted. Chair recognizes Senator from the 41st for a motion to
move for unanimous consent to withdraw Amendment 1.
Without objection, Amendment 1 will be adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the withdrawal? Yes, the senator has withdrawn. Is there objection for the withdrawal amendment number 1? Without objection, amendment number 1 has been withdrawn. It appears we have another amendment that is just a late arriving amendment. Chair recognizes Senator from the 42nd to speak to his amendment that just arrived.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, this amendment, which I believe is Amendment 3, and will be on your desks shortly, is also found, the language is also found in Senate Bill 49. Which is currently pending in the Ethics Committee and awaiting a hearing. What the amendment simply does is that it says that the Ethics Commission, rather than being appointed by the partisan elected officials in this body and in the governor's office, that it would be appointed by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Georgia and the Chief Judge of the Georgia Court of Appeals. I think it's important to have an ethics commission that is independent of the primary partisan elected officials that it serves to govern. I think that if we allow the Chief Justice and the Chief Judge of the Court of Appeals to appoint the members of the Ethics Commission, it will restore some public trust in that commission, and it will be better for all of us because there won't be any doubt that it's independent of us. And so when you know, to the extent that I think it benefits us as members of this body, I think it benefits the members of the executive branch, and I believe that it would serve the citizens of Georgia to make a more transparent and clear appointment process and prevent anybody from ever claiming that appointment process has anything to do with politics. That's the simple amendment. And if you would like to see a typed version of it, again, Senate Bill 49 is available there at Section 2, but it's also been reprinted in my hand script, which I apologize is a little bit messy, but that's what it does, and I'm happy to show you this document, or the amendment will be on your desks momentarily.
Oh, yeah.
You have a question, Senator.
Is Mr. President, is there a way to project a document onto the board?
They're working on that as we speak. Okay. It's a little bit light, so it's difficult to read. Oh, no, they've darkened it up, okay.
And just so that everybody knows, what this does is currently the commission has three members appointed by the governor. And we would take those three members, rather than appointed by the governor, they'd be appointed by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. Currently, two members are appointed by the language that I still have says the Senate Committee on Assignments and the Speaker of the House. And we would take those two legislative appointments, and they would be appointed by the Chief Judge of the Georgia Court of Appeals. So to the extent that it changes the current language, it replaces the governor's appointments with appointments by the Chief Justice, and it replaces the legislative appointments with appointments by the Chief Judge. Otherwise, the other language is gone. It also would call, of course, for reconstituting the commission effective July the 1st, 2014.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 56 for a question.
Senator, yield.
I'll yield.
Senator, in your amendment, isn't it true that you said you wanted to take away the power from the elected official, being the governor and the legislature, to make it a more ethical process?
No, I said that it would be, I don't know that it would make it more ethical, but I do want to take the responsibility and the power for appointing the governing body of our state ethics commission that oversees the way that we act, both in terms of our campaign finances and other things, from the partisan elected officials in the legislature and in the governor's office. I do, and I don't think that people here that I have seen, I don't think it makes it more or less ethical. I think it makes it more transparent, and it makes it less prone to being questioned.
Thank you, Senator. Will you yield for a further question?
I'll yield.
Can you tell me how the two members of the court for the Supreme Court and Court of Appeals come into office?
They're elected in nonpartisan elections.
But they're elected.
Absolutely.
Chair recognizes Senator on the 33rd for a question.
Senator, there are members of both parties that may have a sitting governor that possibly don't agree on everything. There are folks that have a sitting governor in their party but do not agree with him on a lot of things and have some differences with him. Is that not right?
I'm sure that's right.
Is it not true that what we're trying to do with your amendment is to take away any appearance of partisanship and decisions made, and even the inference for the general public?
That is exactly what we're trying to do.
And as finally, as you stated, these are nonpartisan elected officials. Is that right?
That's exactly right.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 31st for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator, yield.
I'll yield.
What is your profession?
I'm an attorney.
Is it your belief that those in the judicial branch are more ethical than those in the legislative branch?
It's my belief that they're nonpartisan and independent of the electoral, of the legislative and the administrative branches, executive branches.
Nonpartisan in what way? Just that they are elected in a nonpartisan election, or that they don't have an opinion?
I think that they're elected in a nonpartisan way.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 48th.
Will Senator yield for a question?
I'll yield to the President, my President pro tem.
Isn't it true that current law requires the governor, regardless of his or her party, to appoint members of the opposite party to the commission so that there's an assurance to the people of this state that the commission will have a representation from all the major parties?
It is true that the current law says that of the governor's three members that he or she appoints, not more than two of them shall be from the same political party.
And will the Senator yield for another question?
I'll yield.
And am I reading your amendment correctly that you would remove that protection and allow a situation where the commission could be dominated entirely, 100%, by members of the same political party?
It does remove that because it would be nonpartisan. I don't know that it's good to have somebody on the Ethics Commission who's the Democrat on the Ethics Commission or the Republican on the Ethics Commission. I think that if it's going to be a nonpartisan body, we would all be better off. But it does, to be honest and clear, it does remove that provision that requires them to not be from the same political party. whether you have a four, you know, so yes, it does remove that protection. I believe that making the entire commission nonpartisan is a better protection than ensuring that, as is currently there, you have four members from one party and one member from another, which leads, as you know, to a 4-to-1 vote.
Will the senator yield for one more question?
Absolutely, Mr. President.
And I just want to make sure I understand the amendment correctly, since it's handwritten and was just passed out.
Yeah.
I do understand that the members of the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court are run as nonpartisan members, but there's nothing in this amendment of yours that would require the five members of the State Ethics Commission to be nonpartisan.
There is nothing that requires the members of the State Ethics Commission to be nonpartisan. In fact, but right now they're required to be partisan. I mean, and that's one of the problems, I think, is, and we remove it from the partisan politics, it helps, as the senator from the 33rd said, it helps to instill some confidence in the people of Georgia that we are having a commission that's not about politics. It's about ensuring transparency. It's ensuring that we can conduct ourselves in a good way. And that's the kind of protection that we all want. I mean, we all want to ensure that we have a credible entity that is governing our practices on the Ethics Commission and with respect to lobbyists, with respect to campaign finance.
Will the senator yield for another question?
I'll yield.
I apologize. I'm growing a little bit more confused.
I will yield all afternoon, Senator.
You indicated that the current law requires the commission to be partisan, but actually the only requirement of current law is that one of the governor's appointees must be from an opposite party of the governor.
It says no more than two shall be from the same political party.
Right. So you could have two nonpartisan as long as so there's no, as you read current law, there's no requirement that they all be partisan.
There is a requirement that at least two of them have identifiable political parties.
At least two of them are not of the same party as the other. So there's no requirement that every member of the commission now be partisan.
No. There is no requirement, for example, that is right. There is no requirement that they be partisan other than that the current law requires that the governor may not appoint more than two from the same political party.
Would Senator yield for another question?
I will certainly yield.
Sometimes members of the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court are not elected in nonpartisan elections. Sometimes if there's a vacancy, the governor will appoint to that position.
That's correct.
Do you have any concern about a Chief Justice or a judge who was appointed by a partisan governor then making this decision?
No.
You have no concern about that at all?
Well, I think that the Chief Justice and the way we select the Chief Justice and the Chief Judge is the courts make those selections. And I believe that once somebody gets appointed in that way, they eventually face the voters in a nonpartisan election. And I believe that they are appointed as nonpartisan people. And so I think that, you know, to the extent that you're questioning the partisanship, and I'm not trying to say that you are, but to the extent that there's a question about whether or not someone might know the partisan affiliation of a judge, I mean, you know, there's nothing we can do about that, but they're sworn to uphold the Constitution in a very different way that is independent as its separate branch of government from the legislature and from the executive branches. And it's just, is it a perfect system? Probably not. But is it much better than the system we have now? I believe it is.
And I'm not, Senator, you know, for another question, I'm not questioning any of the members of the court. I'm just trying to understand the amendment that you're proposing.
No, and I appreciate it.
So I do understand correctly that there's no protection in this amendment that would prevent a judge who was appointed by a partisan governor and had never faced election from the voters from appointing members to this State Ethics Commission. There's nothing in your amendment that would prevent that from occurring. Is that correct?
Only if that person became the Chief Justice or the Chief Judge without ever having to face the voters, which I think is almost impossible. I would have to go back and look at the rules on that, but I don't believe that we've ever been able to do that with the actual Chief Judge or the Chief Justice, because those people are selected by the court according to their rules, and I do not think that those rules, and I'm pleading some ignorance here, but I don't believe that is a concern, given that they have to have ascended to the position of Chief Judge or Chief Justice before they get this appointment power.
So as I understand your answer, you don't think that's likely to happen, but there's nothing in your amendment that would prevent that from happening.
That is correct, I believe.
And so to summarize, there's nothing in your amendment that would prevent this commission from being dominated 100% by the five members of the same political party. You don't believe that's likely. You're not concerned if that might happen because the judges themselves are elected nonpartisan. But there's nothing in this amendment that would protect that from happening, although current law does provide that protection. Am I correct in understanding that?
You are incorrect insofar as the following. The current law provides no real protection. I mean, and the reason is because, you know, if I offered you the single position, one out of five votes, and called it protection, you would say that's not protection. And so I think that what we will do is we will make this commission nonpartisan, period. And today, you know, there is a requirement in here that we consider the partisan affiliation of the party. So to the extent that there is no longer a partisan requirement, you are correct. So to the extent, but I would say that the protection that we are seeking is let's make this commission nonpartisan. Let's make this commission independent of the executive branch, independent of the legislative branch, because those are the folks that run in partisan elections. And if we want to convince the people of Georgia that we're doing the right thing, that we're standing up for what's right, that they have, we have a legitimate oversight over things like campaign finance, over things like lobbyists, we might as well do that in a branch that doesn't get lobbied and doesn't run in partisan elections. That's my only point. I think that. So I would say it is more protective of the public trust to have this be done by the court system, which is independent of the truly political branches, than it is to be done with considering partisanship. You are right that I am doing away with the requirement that they would be two or more from the same political party, but I think you're overstating a little bit the protection you get from getting one vote out of four.
So, and I've got one other line of questions, but
please,
so
I'll yield.
Just to understand, so you view the current protection as being limited, and so you're removing that limited protection and then giving us no statutory protection. We're just simply going to rely. Let me ask you a question, if you'll yield for another question.
I'll yield.
Does the state Transparency and Campaign Finance Commission, does it regulate the campaign financing of judicial elections as well?
I believe that it does.
You're not sure?
Yeah, it does.
It does. One other question. Are you aware of the members of the judicial branch appointing members of any other executive agency other than this one here that you've proposed in this amendment?
I'm not aware.
Do you think that it might violate the separation of powers provisions of the state constitution, which require the legislative, executive, and judicial branches to be separate and distinct?
I don't.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 54th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will my friend in the well yield?
I'll yield for my friend from Dalton.
Thank you very much, Senator. You'll be glad to know your response to the pro tem indicated all afternoon. We haven't yet reached afternoon, and I hope we don't. You won't while I'm here. Senator, isn't it true that the gift limitations, the campaign contribution limitations to judicial offices do not exist as compared to the limitations on those for executive or legislative branches?
I honestly don't know.
Thank you, Senator. Will the Senator further yield for a few questions?
I'll yield.
Senator, to follow up on a couple of the questions that were raised earlier and maybe draw them together, isn't it true that the respective chiefs, the Chief Justice of Georgia and the Chief Judge of the Georgia Court of Appeals, in today's state of affairs, both of whom I have great respect for, and I believe that the Senator Noel does, both achieved their current office originally by appointment from governors?
I know that that is true for the Chief Justice. I believe it is true for the Chief Judge.
Okay. Senator, is it your understanding that the chiefs, both together, also have appointment powers to the Judicial Qualifications Council, the JQC?
I believe that's right. They have appointment powers to a host of entities.
And so if I understand your amendment correctly, we would be allowing these elected officials, originally appointed in a political process, to appoint both the council that governs their activities in office and the council which governs their election to office, and the ethical, is that correct? Would that be true if we adopted your amendment and passed this bill?
I believe that it would. But let me tell you, if you really think this is a bad idea to have somebody other than the governor and the legislature appoint the ethics commission, I mean, I almost don't believe that. I mean, I just think that, yeah, I know there's politics. I know that this is a moment in time, and everybody's got pasts and futures and everything else. But this is trying to convince and let our people and the citizens of this state see that the folks that we are governed by are going to be the most independent people we can find. I mean, it, you know, at some level, we've got to find a way to do it. The governor and the leaders of the two legislative bodies are the wrong people, in my view, to make that appointment. I think it's much better to have someone who's independent of the executive branch, independent of the legislative branch, making that appointment. That's all I'm saying. It's not a perfect system. You know, it's not a perfect system, but it is a much better system than the one we have now for us. Because you know, it just doesn't make sense. You know, you're saying maybe it will undermine the credibility of those of the judiciary. But I just don't think that it will. It certainly won't undermine the credibility of the judiciary to the same extent that it undermines or to, that the current system undermines folks' faith in the commission. That's all I'm saying.
Well, I understand. I believe the senator's concerns and have great respect for that. My question, I guess, in closing, is a lot of the discussion has been about parties of various appointees and whether they have parties or don't have parties. And my question, I guess, as a Georgian, is your interest in partisanship or impartiality? And the reason I ask the question is it seems to me that what we should be seeking is individuals who can dispense justice and judgment impartially, regardless of party, rather than focus on what party they are or are not a part of. And it seems to me to say, because we're assuming people are in one party, they will somehow be against those of another or somehow wield that judgment differently than others, is really unfair to members of both parties and even nonpartisan individuals, because it perpetuates this myth that team mentality of party is trumps our impartiality in positions of responsibility.
I think that's well said. But what I'm really looking for, it has to be impartiality, I agree. But it also has to be credibility. And that credibility outside the Capitol with the people and the citizens of Georgia, I believe, will be increased if the appointment is not made by the people that are the highest profile folks that this committee regulates. I just believe that it's in addition to impartiality, you've got to have credibility. And that's the important piece. I believe we would increase the credibility, not the integrity, but the credibility of the commission if it was appointed by the judicial branch rather than the branches that are the most highest profile partisan offices that it regulates.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 41st for a question.
Senator, is it not true that and I appreciate you bringing this for us to discuss today. Is it not true that, you know, we could have had a hearing on a couple of bills, one to independently finance the Ethics Commission, one to create some method of appointments of a less obligated or a more credible appointments, if we would have hearings and discussions, and if the committees would address that within this body?
Yeah, I mean, again, this piece of legislation that is now in the form of an amendment was filed, and I forget the date, but at the beginning of this session, years, you know, over a year ago, and it's been waiting for a hearing for over a year. And so that's this piece of legislation. In addition, there's other pieces of legislation that you mentioned that have been pending for over a year to that would dedicate funding for the State Ethics Commission. And what that means is that you would insulate the State Ethics Commission from the appropriations process, which would allow us to say, look, no matter what happens, we're not going to punish the State Ethics Commission, or it will be insulated from any appropriations or retribution or anything else. And if we can do that, that is pending. I would love to have a hearing and a discussion on that. I didn't believe it was germane to this piece of legislation we have today because it's a constitutional amendment. But yes, I'm excited to have the discussion, as you said earlier, Senator, on the floor of the Senate, because we haven't been able to have it yet in the committee process.
Thank you. And would you further yield, Senator?
I'll yield.
Wouldn't you think that when you have a situation with the State Ethics Commission that has been, you know, under some questionable credibility, you've had a chairman who told
a staff member, the exec director, that they couldn't continue with an investigation because there wasn't enough money, even though the FBI agreed to help, and then loses their job shortly after. You have a ethics commission that has had many people interviewed by the FBI and questioned. You have an ethics commission who has had whistleblower lawsuits and employees that say they were ordered to redact files from cases by their superiors. You have an ethics commission that is not properly functioning. Do you not expect that the leadership of this body in this state would try to restore confidence in such a commission?
I mean, I honestly don't want to comment on that because there's a lot of stuff that's going on. We filed this piece of legislation long ago. I think it is a good piece of legislation, but the current situation, I think, is irrelevant.
Senator from the 33rd is recognized for a question.
Senator, let me ask you a question. Is it not true that there have been many pieces of legislation this year introduced and in the past years, most especially by members of both parties, who want to make district attorneys nonpartisan?
Yes, there has been such legislation.
And isn't the reason, because just as judges enjoy that nonpartisan role, because they have authority over people's lives in many different ways, they would like to take the politics out of that, and that's one reason they've introduced that in law enforcement or the district attorney in the judicial circuits. Is that not right?
That is the argument that the supporters of those legislation make.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
The Secretary will read the amendment, please. Amendment number 3.
Senator Carter of the 42nd amends SB 297 by adding Section 5 as follows. Chapter 5 of Section 21 shall be amended by striking Code Section 2154B and replacing it with the following. B1. Effective July 1st, 2014, the Commission shall be reconstituted. 2. The Commission shall be governed by 5 members appointed as follows. 3 members shall be appointed by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Georgia for a term of 4 years, 1 for a term of 3 years, and 1 for a term of 2 years. And 2 members shall be appointed by the Chief Judge of the Georgia Court of Appeals, 1 for a term of 3 years, and 1 for a term of four years. Upon expiration of a member's term in office, a new member appointed in the same manner as the member whose term in office as provided in the paragraph shall become a member of the commission and shall serve for a term of 4 years and until such member's successor is duly appointed and qualified. If a vacancy occurs in the membership of the commission, a new member shall be appointed to the unexpired term of the office by the justice or judge who appointed the vacating member. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Senator 42nd, do you want to withdraw your amendment? Senator from the 42nd, you want to withdraw your amendment? Did you want to withdraw your amendment on number 3? The unconstitutional amendment? Or were you wanting to? Did you want to vote on it? Do you want to vote on amendment number 3? All those in favor of amendment number 3, rise, stand and be counted. If you're in favor of amendment number 3, rise, stand and be counted. Reverse. Thank you. on the amendment. The yeas are 14 and the nays are 31, and amendment number 3 has been lost. Question now is on the adoption of the committee substitute as amended. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is amended is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection? Agreeing to port of committee, wish to favor pass the bill. Chair is none. Report of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is none. The main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? The question is on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 46, the nays are 6, and this bill having received the constitutional majority is therefore passed. Chair recognizes Senator on the 16th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the Senate immediately transmit SB 297 to the House.
Is there objection? Without objection, the bill will be immediately transmitted. Senator from the 29th, what purpose you rise? You got an announcement. Okay, we'll wait. Chair recognizes. Chair recognizes Senator from the 16th, the Majority Leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the Senate stand adjourned pursuant to H.R. 1108 until 10 a.m. Monday, January 27th.
Read the announcements.
Rules will be meeting upon adjournment and 450 cap. That completes the order, Mr. President.
Rules committee meeting. Do not miss it for those that are on the committee. Chair recognizes Senator on the 29th for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. President. I've got two announcements. For all of the attorneys, all the lawyer legislators, today is the day for the Georgia Bar Journal cover photo. It's at 11:30 on the steps of the North Wing staircase. Also, the Metropolitan Court Clerks Association of Georgia is having their meeting in Capitol Room 216 upon adjournment. Thank you.
Any other announcements? The Majority Leader has moved that we stand adjourned pursuant to our adjournment resolution and reconvene on Monday at 10 a.m. All of those in favor will say aye. All those opposed, no. And the noes are very weak and the ayes clearly have it. We stand adjourned.